Good afternoon, everyone. Welcome to MSCAC Talks. MSCAC Talks is a monthly seminar series focused on bringing the tech community together to discuss the role of technology in society. We aim to bring together developers, researchers, and industry experts to discuss exciting topics at the forefront of technological innovation. These talks are hosted by the MSCAC program, a world-class graduate research program that provides industry partners with direct access to applied research talent. Now, on to our speaker. I'm excited to introduce today's guest speaker, Vera, Liao. Vera is a principal researcher at Microsoft Research Montreal, where she's part of the Fairness, Accountability, Transparency, and Ethics of AI group. Her current research interests are in human-AI interaction, explainable AI, and responsible AI. Her talk today will provide an overview on the technical and design methods associated with explainable AI systems. Over to you, Vera.
Thank you so much. Thanks for having me. Let me start my screen sharing. Let's jump into it. So last November, I visited a CS department at UFT. So today I'm actually going to try to give a less researchy kind of talk. I will focus on this topic of explainable AI, and here is my agenda. I will start with talking about what is explainable AI, and then I will introduce some methods, talking about how to explain AI. My own research background is in human-computer interaction, so I will try to touch on both the algorithmic side and also the design side. And I will touch on why is explainable AI important, especially now we talk about responsible AI, ethical AI. And I also touch on how to design explainable AI application. What are some design considerations? So since I only have an hour, I may not get into some of the algorithm detail or research study detail, but I can share my slides later. You'll see I always have references at the bottom of my slides. So what is explainable AI, right? I think there are kinds of two definitions going around. A lot of time when you think about explainable AI, especially the more technical field, they refer to techniques or methods that make AI or machine learning model the decision understandable by people. There's also broader definition. Some people use the term comprehensible AI, intelligible AI, that is broadly considered anything that makes AI system more understandable, taking this more human-centered definition of explainable AI, right? So again, XAI is also not just a machine learning system. There are also robotics, planning, but today I'm mostly going to focus on explaining supervised machine learning system, right? We take this very much toy example, right? If you are training a machine learning model, trying to recognize an object is an apple or is a cake. So there are data parts, there's the algorithm part. Lots of the technique part, focusing on this part, is to explain, I'm recognizing this is a cake and why is that? But broadly, we can also consider things like explaining the training data characteristics, as well as explaining this kind of model facts, right? What is the input and output space? What is performance limitation? And also the development process. So these are, we can all consider this information as explainable AI. So chances are you have heard this term in academic work, in public discussion, on the news. There's also related term like interpretable machine learning. It's also in the regulation, right? So GDPR, this European law, requires that whenever you have automated decision making system, people have rights to meaningful information, explanation of how the decision is made. And all this, the kind of backdrop is, of course, AI is increasingly being used to augment human decision or even automate decision tasks. And then even in those kind of high-stake domain like healthcare, transportation, So without the kind of human scrutinization, right, it's dangerous to have that kind of AI system. And also users in those kind of domain, they tend to be more cautious. Without understanding the system, they may be reluctant to trust the system or adopt the system. So what are the technical challenges here? Why do we need this whole technical field of explainable AI, right? I'll start with the point that not all machine learning models are directly explainable, right? On the one side, you maybe have a relatively simple intuitive model like a decision tree or linear model, but they tend to not perform as well. On the other side, especially recently, right, people start using like complex deep learning, deep neural networks or ensemble tree. They are complex, lack transparency, and also they are just not following the kind of a human understandable intuitive process. So you may have heard this term, explainability performance trade-off, which is talking about this kind of dilemma that complex models tend to perform well, but they're harder to understand. But I want to point out that this only holds in average training setting, right? If you have a model, you have well-structured data, you have a meaningful feature, you can also achieve good performance using those relatively simple algorithms. So if we look at all these different algorithms, technique, there may be hundreds of them, generally they fall into two camps. One camp is to have directly explainable model. One example, as I mentioned, are linear model, decision tree, rule-based model. They tend to be simple, intuitive. On the other side, we have what's called post-hoc explainability, meaning that if you already decide to train a complex model, a deep neural network, then you need another set of algorithms to generate explanation. So that's what's called post hoc explainability. So on the left side, more recent research work is also trying to break this kind of trade-off, trying to develop new algorithms that perform better, but still maintain some of these human intuitive characteristics. I just gave you two examples. One is called GAM, right? GAM is a model that instead of just using linear regression, it also considers the interaction between features. So it performs better than linear model, but it still provides this kind of visualization or other approach to help you understand the interaction. Another example is called generalized linear rule model. In a very simple term is they're trying to produce more sophisticated rules, right? Consider the law and relationship. So they perform better, but you can still see the model as what kind of rules it follows. So moving to the right side, right? A lot of algorithms fall into this kind of post hoc explainability. Again, it's you start with a deep neural network or ensemble tree, then you want another set of technique to generate explanation. So I want to give you an overall how this different algorithm, their output look like. As I mentioned, I will not get into the algorithm technique detail. What I'm going to do is I will use a fictional use case and show you fictional explanation, basically how the output of those algorithms look like. And I will focus on the method, not the algorithmic details. Again, reference is at the bottom of my slides. I also want to mention that at the current time, if you want to implement a lot of the algorithms I covered today, there are this kind of XAI toolkits available. They are open source code library. You can plug in your own data or plug in your own model and take advantage of the state of the art algorithm. One example is I work for Microsoft. We have a tool called InterpretML. Another example is IBM AX360, which was my previous job was at IBM. So that toolkit is actually what got me into working on the topic. So if you're interested, please check them out. So coming back, the kind of the use case I'm going to use today is there is a decision support ML system for non-application approval, meaning that this machine learning system is going to take a profile of a loan applicant, a bank customer, and make a prediction that whether this person has a high or low risk of repaying the loan. And that will help the loan officer to make the final judgment if this loan application should be approved. This is an interesting use case also because there are different stakeholders in this use case that they can really benefit from having explanation, right? There is this data scientist who developed the model, and they may want explanation to investigate a model, and if it's not performing well, they may want to debug the model. Then you have the loan officer who is the direct user of this decision support system. And then what they want to do is they want to have explanation and assess if the model prediction is right and help them make the final judgment. And another type of stakeholder is sometimes we call impacted people. So they are the bank customer. They are not directly interacting with the machine learning model, but whether their loan will be approved is mediated by this machine learning system, and their life can be really impacted. So if their loan is rejected, for example, they might want the reason behind to understand why it's rejected and how they can improve in the future. So now consider this post hoc explainability, right? There are three kinds of explanation that this algorithm can generate. The first one is called a global explanation, which is try to generate explanation that give you an overview of the model, how it works, what kind of rule it follows, how it generally sees as important features. So a lot of this kind of algorithm, what they're actually doing is what's called knowledge distillation or approximation, meaning that you have this, again, complex model you already trained. And their logic is not directly explainable. So in general, what this algorithm is trying to do is to try to train a simpler model, like a rule-based model or decision tree, to approximate the complex model's decision. And of course, when you do optimization, you may lose some information. So there are a lot of algorithms trying to optimize minimize this loss of information between the two. So how do they look like, right? For example, this algorithm, what it does is basically produces this simpler decision tree to proxy the complex model, right? So if, for example, if you're a data scientist and you want to investigate the model, you can look at what is the general rule this model is trying to follow in this decision tree format and trying to see, is this logic reasonable? Is there something wrong that I need to debug the model? Another kinds of algorithm can produce this kind of rule sets, right? Very similar to a decision tree, but in this kind of rule format, for example, saying if the SS score is above 90, and then you may get prediction or low. So again, data scientists can use that to investigate the logic. This kind of rule format is also more user-friendly, and the loan officer, for example, the user of the decision system, for example, when they're doing the onboarding stage, they might be interested in what kind of customer does the model consider as low risk? Does that align with my domain experience? And if so, they may have a better trust of the system. So moving to the second kinds of explanation, it's called the local explanation, which is to explain a particular prediction or decision the model makes. So consider the model is making this particular prediction looking at this customer called Jason, and the customer has this profile and is making a prediction that this person has low risk of repaying. So the model is trying, so the explanation is trying to tell you why the model it thinks that Jason has low risk of repaying. So one very common type of explanation is what's called feature contribution, which is basically tell you, looking at the profile of Jason, right? The different feature of Jason contributing to the final decision. And especially Jason's assessed score is giving a big negative contribution, and that really determines that JSON is considered low risk. And this kind of explanation is very helpful for the decision maker, the user of the system. They want to look at individual decision, and they want to understand, why is JSON predictive low risk? And also, can I trust this prediction, or instead I should trust myself? So if you have ever used any explainability algorithm, you might have heard the Lime algorithm and Shapley algorithm. These are the most popular two algorithms. So I very quickly talk a little bit about what the Lime does. So essentially it's taking this black box original model, a deep neural network, and it wants to explain this particular input and output. What Lime does is to take this black box and take this particular prediction and also sample its neighboring instance, and then build a simpler model, usually a linear model, at the local region. And then it uses the weights of the linear model to explain the black box model's decision at this particular local region. It's a very popular algorithm. It's also because it can be used to generate local explanation for any kind of model or any kind of data, right? If you have a tabular data, as example says, you can visualize the weights. If your image data is basically highlighting patches of image, or you call super pixel. If you have a text, then it highlights like which keywords contributes to the final prediction. So besides this kind of feature-based explanation, another kind of popular category of explanation is to explain by examples to support this kind of case-based reasoning, right? So instead of telling you the weights of how JSON's profile contribute to decision, this kind of algorithm can generate examples. For example, finding from the training data, these are the two existing customer that has profile very similar to JSON, and then both of them also repaid on time. So it gives this kind of justification, and also for a lot of people, they will find this example-based explanation easier to consume, help them understand why JSON is considered to have low risk. And moving on, the third kind of explanation is what's called inspecting counterfactual. What does counterfactual mean, right? That's usually you have this particular prediction, but what you are interested is counter to the factual. You are interested is how you can get a different prediction, usually the more desirable prediction. Case in point here is, for example, you have a customer, and the customer's known get rejected. The machine learning predicts that this person has high repaying risk. And what this customer is actually interested is, how can I improve? How can I get a low risk prediction and get loan approved in the future? So what very popular kinds of explanation is what's called contrastive feature. So what it does is to look for which feature that you can perturb to get a different prediction, and usually what's the minimum you can perturb, right? For example, in this case, the explanation tells the person that focus on your depth percentage. If you reduce that from 50 to 30, you will get a low risk prediction. So that helps the bank customer to improve their future chance to really seek recourse. Again, besides feature-based explanation, you can also utilize example to help people understand. So that's what's called counterfactual example. So this kind of algorithm search for example that is similar to Anna, this customer, but getting a different prediction. For example, in this case, they find this example in the training data. Another customer could sue that's relatively similar to Anna, but the sue is able to repay on time. And by comparing these two profile, Anna might realize that, oh, this person, everything else looks similar for me, but has a lower depth percentage. And then that may be the places that I should focus on. So that is a very, very quick overview of this kind of a different algorithm. I want to very quickly say words of this choice between using a directly explainable model or using a post hoc explainability. So this is a very much debated topic, right? There are a lot of discussion around you should not use post hoc explainability because they are not completely faithful to what the model is actually doing, especially in certain either high stake domain or domain where you actually want to debug the model. But in reality, there are a lot of times you just have to go with the post hoc explainability because one, directly explainable model may not always perform as well, especially if you don't have meaningful feature. You don't want to spend a lot of time to do feature engineering. And sometimes it's simply impossible to have a directly explainable model. You might be working with pre-trained model or preparatory model. So you have to work with a complex black box model. And then in those situations, you just have to go with post hoc explainability. So moving on to the second part of my talk, we want to cover why is explainable AI important and why should we consider it as a foundation for the topic of responsible AI. So you may have heard this term responsible AI or related trustworthy AI, ethical AI. What their concern is really about how do we put ethical principle of AI into practice, right? How do we develop AI system that minimize their potential harms to people, to society, and maximize their benefit? And usually at the current time, how we approach this responsible AI is to consider different pillars or different principles that whenever you are developing an AI system that you should satisfy, right? So if you look at this kind of standard going around, they often talk about whenever you develop an AI system, you want it to be explainable or transparent. You want it to be fair. You want it to be safe and also have accountability, right? So these are different principles. But in my view, right, the explainability is actually the kind of foundation for what the other pillar, what the other principles we talk about, right? Because explainability fundamentally is about helping people understand AI, right? But if we have a better understanding, we can improve the model, achieve better competence. We can ensure fairness, safety. We can help the user to have better usability, trust in the system, as well as to ensure the kind of accountability and have the oversight for privacy, security issues as well. So I'm going to pick a few pillars and give you an example why explainability is important, right? So first we start with competence. Again, as we discussed with the other use case, explainability is often considered can be the interface to help data scientists to do this kind of debugging work, understand why this model is not performing as well. Do I need to get more training data? How do I improve it, right? So that's how explainability intersect with competence. I also want to point out at current time, for example, in the HCI community, people are working on a lot of this kind of debugging interface, debugging tool, which usually incorporate multiple kinds of explanation. You have a global explanation to understand the model logic. You have local explanation to delve into this particular mistake the model make. And you can see usually this kind of interface tend to utilize the visualization as data scientists are familiar with this kind of interface. I also want to say a few things about the intersection between explainability and fairness, right? So fairness, why is fair ML such an important topic, right? What is fair ML at a very, very high level, right? So whenever you train a machine learning model, the disparity is a given. But if the model discriminate certain unprivileged group, whether it's racial group, age, gender, disability, then that makes the model to be an unfair model, and it's even illegal in certain contexts, right? A very prominent example that people talk a lot is this campus system. All right, so campus is a software that's already used in some part of the criminal justice system in the United States. So it's a machine learning model trained in historical data of arrest. And if you the model sees, for example, an offendant, and it makes a prediction whether this person has high or low risk of getting reoffended. So the judges are already using this kind of system to help them to make, for example, bail decision. If this person has high risk of reoffend, then the bail may be set high or not allowed to have bail decision. ProPublica at some point published a long audit of the system showing that this kind of software actually exhibit discrimination against certain racial group, right? For example, looking at the profile of a white offender and black offender, their profile is very similar, but the model gave a much higher prediction to black offender. That's because the model is trained in this kind of historical arresting data, and then there are certain discrimination biases of the law enforcement. So that is really a very prominent cases. And since then, there has been a lot of discussion around fairness of ML. How can we improve the fairness of machine learning model? I would say a lot of work is around more statistical algorithmic work. For example, how do we really retrain a model or quote unquote de-bias the model to improve the fairness? But there's another side of it is because there are many different definitions of fairness, and also there's a question of which group, what kind of feature exhibit fairness. It's always desirable to have a human in the loop to investigate a model or audit a model to identify, is there a fairness issue, what kind of fairness issue there is, and how can we have strategy to mitigate that biases. So that's where explanation can come into place, right? Explanation is really this interface for this auditor to look into the model and identify, is there biases? I will not get into the detail of this research. This is a study that my collaborator and I, we run back in 2019. So we basically developed this kind of interface using campus as an example that we generate this kind of four kinds of explanation. Again, we have contrastive explanation, which shows if you change some feature of this person, you will get a different prediction. And then you have example-based explanation, talk about the model thinks this offender will reoffend, but based on similar cases, only 60% actually have the kind of outcome. We also have this kind of a global explanation. We have global feature importance, which talks about how the model generally weighs different features. And you can see the model actually gave a certain weight to the racial feature of the data. And then you also have data distribution, which helps people understand the kind of biases in the data. So from that kind of study, we basically show all these different kinds of explanation can help people audit the model and identify is there biases. Especially contrastive explanation is very useful because it just really highlights that if you just change the risk a bit of this person, you get a different prediction, and really highlight if the model is unbiased, explanation can review that kind of biases. And that helps we move forward to improve the model to mitigate these biases. And another important use cases people talk about explainable AI is this kind of human AI decision-making or AI-assisted decision-making, right? Again, that long application use case is a very good example, right? What you have here is you have a machine learning model, but who actually makes a decision is this human decision maker. So explanation here, the hope is that one is explanation can support appropriate trust and reliance because we know machine learning system always makes mistakes in some cases. So it's important to help the decision maker to know when to rely on the AI or not, if this particular prediction has flawed reasoning and we should be more cautious. Another reason that decision maker needs explanation is that it can help them make more informed action, right? For example, if the loan officer wants to advise clients how to improve, and the hope is that explanation gave them some insights of how the client can improve. But I want to briefly highlight that the hope is not a reality. This is actively researched topic. The state of the art is a lot of this kind of feature-based, important-based explanation, they do not necessarily deliver this kind of benefit. And that points also, there are a lot of remaining challenge of how do we design explanation in a way that's more human compatible. And lastly, I want to call out this relationship with accountability, right? A current trend is also, besides this different algorithm generating explanation, another trend in this broader explainability transparency community is to produce AI documentation. One example is, so Microsoft, our Azure Cognitive Service, has something called Transparency Note. And Google has something called model cards. And model cards is also implemented in other company, for example, Hugging Face. What they generally do is whenever you have a model that you want the people to access, you want to give people this kind of documentation, not only telling like, what does this model do? What is the input output? What are the performance? What are the training data? You also want to tell people what are the appropriate or intended use case and what is not intended. So that really facilitate this kind of one is responsible use, right? If I'm a consumer of the model, I want to know, should I use it for my particular use case or application? It also facilitate accountability as either auditors or general public can audit if a model is really following the right procedure. Is it safe to use, for example? So now let's move on to the last part of my talk. I want to briefly touch on some design consideration, right? While we're talking about more on the algorithm side of explanation, but the point is, whenever you integrate algorithm in a system, you also need to consider the interface side of design and also what kind of explanation you should use in a particular machine learning or AI system. For the time being, I want to focus on one big design challenge, which is there's no one fits all solution, right? Although I've been talking about there are different kinds of algorithm, and then they have different kinds of objective, right? Well, explanation to support debugging, to support fairness, to support decision-making, they look very different and they have different kinds of goal to achieve. The point is also the stakeholder group, right? There are many different people that they might want explanation. Again, going back to that loan application use case, right? There are the typical kinds of stakeholder group that often needs explanation. One is the model developer, right? They need explanation for debugging. You maybe have domain experts who wants to verify the model and trying to judge if they should use the model. And then you have regulator who needs to audit the model, business owner trying to decide if you want to use a particular model. And then you have decision maker, impact group, as we discussed in the use case. With that, and then you also paired with this different system, deploying different kinds of contexts, right? They have different domain, they have different social contexts. Then you pair with, how do I find the right kind of algorithm? Consider all these differences, right? So that's the kind of general challenge of how do we make the choice of different algorithm? How do we find the right pairing? So that has been my own research interest in the past few years, just how do we facilitate that kind of choices, right? So today I want to spend the rest of the time to introduce the design method that came out of our research. We call it a question-driven explainable AI design. What it is essentially a user-centered design process that starts with identify users' explainable needs specific to application or even an interaction. Now I try to find the right pairing between user needs and different XAI technique. It's also a process that, especially in product teams, we encourage this kind of designer-engineer collaboration, right? You want a designer who understands the user experience side of things, and you also want data scientists to be involved to pick the right kind of algorithm to implement. So one fundamental assumption we make in this design methods is that user needs for explainability is expressed by questions, right? There are a whole line of social science literature, HCI literature I will not get into, but the essential idea is that explanation is an answer to a question, and different kinds of question, right? A how question, a why question, a what if question will require different kinds of explanation. So taking this view of question-driven, right? One thing we did in our research is trying to develop this XAI question bank. Again, I have a reference in the bottom and you can easily find the paper on my website. So we basically looked across 16 different AI applications, look at what kind of questions people tend to ask in those applications. Then we try to cluster those questions and then develop this question bank. There are more than 50 questions that clustered in this 9 different category, right? There are data-related questions. There are output-related questions. People are interested in, for example, what is the scope of output? There are performance-related questions. How question is corresponds to this kind of global model-wide explanation. How does the model work? And then you have why question, why not question, focus on particular prediction. Then you have more of a counterfactual question, like how to be that, how to get a different prediction, or how to still be the same. How do I stay in a particular prediction? And there's also what if question and a few other questions as well. So this question bank represents this kind of common space of what kind of needs people have with explainability looking across different AI applications. The another type of work we did was we did a mapping between this 9 categories of question and XAI techniques. Many of that I covered in the first part of my study. So algorithm technique that can answer those questions. And we particularly focus on techniques that are available in current popular XAI toolkits so that, for example, here with the URL, if you click them, you will be able to go to the toolkit and see the implementation detail. Again, I will share the slides later. So by doing this kind of mapping, we also arrive this kind of design guideline in the middle, right? What kind of explanation can answer this question? And they're strictly grounded in the technical feasibility that current algorithm or current technique can generate that kind of explanation. So that is the kind of foundation or a guideline to think about the mapping part. We also have this whole design process we call question-driven design process. And it has 4 steps. I'm going to use a use case to walk you through how to follow this design process. Again, the paper is at the bottom. So I want to mention this is a work that I did in my previous job at IBM. So that was a project we actually partnered with Watson Health. So this is a use case that we're trying to design and develop an AI system for adverse event prediction. The idea is, for example, when doctor is doing discharge in the hospital, they can have this AI system telling them this particular patient may have a high risk of adverse event, unplanned hospitalization. So the doctor needs to pay more attention to this patient and prevent those adverse events. So the first step we suggest is to identify user questions. We want to understand the needs that doctor has when they work with the kind of system. And we want to focus on what kind of questions they ask. So we started with an interview study. We went to talk to the doctors in the hospital. We introduced that we're thinking about developing this kind of AI system. Then we follow up by asking, if you have this kind of AI system working with you, what kind of questions you might have? We also try to probe, why do you have this question? What do you want to achieve with that question? So we talk to many doctors trying to gather those questions as a set of questions, right? Sorry, the answers as a set of questions. For example, right, doctors may be interested in the question of this person get a prediction of high adverse event risk. So why is that? What are the main risk factor for this person? And then they also tell us the reason behind is I want to have that answer to help me better understand the patient, discover is there other non-obvious risk factor that I should pay attention to. So we want both the question itself and also the reasons they're asking those questions. And the second step is you want to analyze the question, right? You want to pull questions from different doctors. You want to see the priority. What are some common questions that many potential user would ask, right? So we did this kind of clustering analysis. We see that, for example, there are lots of questions about why, right? Why this patient have this high risk prediction? Doctor is ultimately interested in how to improve the patient outcome. So they ask this, how to be that question, right? What can be done to reduce the risk? It's also very interesting that doctors are highly interested in this data related question. The main reason is they want to see whether the training data aligns with the demographics of their patients. So the third step is we emphasize that the designer and the data scientist should really sit down together, right? Look at the kind of question, the prioritized question, and then find the right pairing. What kind of algorithm can answer that question? And also consider the particular model, particular type of data they work with. There, the kind of mapping guidance I show you a few slides before can be used as a reference, but we really encourage that it's a collaboration, it's a conversation that designer and data scientists should have together. So they can use this kind of reference table, right? There's a lot of why question. Then the data scientists can look at the suggest technique, their LIME and their SHAP, but they should also consider the particular healthcare data. Does that algorithm apply to the data? And the last step is once you have those decision made, these are the question, these are the potential technique, then designer can start create the right design interface that show this different kinds of algorithm output, and data scientists can think about proceed with implementing those algorithms. So very quickly, this is the actual interface we came up in that project, right? So this interface has this risk prediction of this patient, and you can see there are multiple explainability related features that really corresponds to the kind of question we gathered in the beginning, right? We have this why question, and then here is this kind of visualization that shows the feature contribution of the explanation. And then lots of questions around how to be that, a kind of counterfactual question. Then we have this feature here that really highlight if you change certain bit of feature of this patient, you may improve the kind of healthcare outcome. And then we also have performance related feature, not just like the accuracy, precision of the model, but also uncertainty, because we've got a lot of questions really around how much I should trust this prediction. And then we also designed this tab that show people data-related question, focusing on showing the distribution of the training data to help doctor judge, do they align with their own patients? So very quickly, it's the end of my talk. I just want to very quickly touch on some other kinds of design consideration also from my own work working in this domain, right? One is you should consider choosing the right modality, right? Taking this algorithmic output, a feature contribution, do you want to present it in a visualization? Do you want to present it in a text space, right? So that's a decision to be made. And another really important point is do not overwhelm user, right? Especially in high stake domain, for example, when time and resources constrained, when doctor, for example, they do not want a system that they have to spend a lot of time to inspect explanation. Now here you need to consider things like, for example, what is the amount of information? How many features you want to show to the user? And what's the right level of granularity? Do you want to show every single feature? Or do you want to maybe group some feature and show it at a more general level? It's also important to try to integrate explanation into the overall user workflow and their experience, right? It maybe should not be a feature that's always there and only when people request. Another point I want to highlight is also to achieve this end goal of understanding, sometimes just explanation is not enough. Right, the knowledge gap or information gap, we need other kinds of information. For example, someone may need domain knowledge first. They might have to understand what a feature actually means, or they need some information about how AI generally works, what feature, and also the kind of context they use the AI. There's also this part of if we take this kind of goal, what kind of goal people want to achieve, right? Then maybe having explanation itself is not enough. In that kind of healthcare domain, for example, maybe people also want that to be linked to other kinds of evidence or guideline to help them make the final decisions, not just about opening the black box algorithm and seeing what's inside. There are also cases you might not really want to review the underlying algorithm data. So you may have to come up with some creative solution, for example, to map the explanation to more high-level description as well. And I have another slide that I try to find some links around. So readings about explainable AI, and you can find this kind of toolkits library, there are several of them, as well as a different design guideline from Microsoft, Google, and other company, the particular chapters dedicated to explainability and transparency. Hope that you will enjoy those as well. And with that, I think that's the end of my talk. I want to thank you for your attention, and I'm going to stop sharing for a moment and look at a QA.
Thank you, Vera. And I see that lots of people have put questions already in the Q&A. And so I'll let you go ahead and put them in. If other people want to add questions, now would be a time to do it.
Yeah, I'm just looking at that. I'm not a very quick reader, but let me see. Do you think so I have a question from Liao. I'm just starting from the first question. Do you think the explainability AI literature will increase with mandatory AI-related modules in school? Yes, that's a great question. So I've actually been seeing a lot of literature recently coming out at this intersection of computer science education and XAI, because explanation is a lot of times about filling the information or understanding gap. So they themselves actually carry this kind of value of educational or teaching value. So I think that's a very natural point of using explanation itself as a sort of educational material. So I definitely see that's a very promising area, but I do think there's a lot of design consideration of taking this kind of explanation algorithms, how do we actually make them educational material? And that's a non-trivial task to make. Yeah. Moving on, I have a question that I often got whenever I give talk, is what is the difference between interpretability and explainability? That's a good question. I think I have to say there's no agreed upon definition. Different people use them in different scope. Most commonly, yes, people do consider interpretability as a equivalent of the left part, the directly explainable model. So in that kind of definition, yeah, interpretability is a little bit of a subcategory of explainability. But I've also seen literature go in the reverse and consider interpretability as broader. But I've developed the habit in the past few years that not being focusing on this more human-centered definition about understanding, right? I don't think it's very productive to spend our energy consider defining new term. What is this term versus that per term? I think whether we say interpretability, explainability, the ultimate goal is to improve people's understanding, and then also using this term understanding also get us back into this more human-centered view. What's the end goal we need to deliver? So that's a great question. And let me see. As I have a question from Nicole, there is a discussion in the space around the post hoc explanation. Some academics, like Sincere Rooting, have made a claim that there are inherently interpret models that can perform as well as black box model. What is some use case that may be false and we have to use post hoc method? So I actually have this slide, so I will come back. So that's basically the answer. I particularly cited Cynthia Rooting in the earlier slides talking about this is a much debated topic, which one to choose, right? It's true that post hoc explainability has a lot of concerns because it's not completely faithful to what the model is actually doing. And if given the opportunity that we should use directly explainable model, but there are several reasons that in practice people do have to use post hoc. One is that there are performance issues, especially if you're using certain kind of training data, certain kind of not very meaningful feature, you don't want to spend a lot of efforts doing feature engineering. Then in those kind of cases, usually a deep neural network or complex model tend to perform better. Then you might want to, if you do go through that route, you have to go with post hoc explainability. But there's also a reason, especially these days, people tend to use third-party models a lot that already came with well-packaged. And in those kind of cases, you just don't have the access to training data to retrain the model. Then again, you have to go with post hoc approach. Let's see. More questions. There's a question about fairness. Would you like to give some common fairness measures? And is it a standard protocol to report them in certain industry? That's a great question, but I think that needs another 45 minutes talk. I think there is a talk like 27 definition of fairness or something. So there are a lot of definitions going around. Two common definition, that one is the kind of group fairness, meaning that you want to have different subgroup, either demographic group or others, that to reach a comparable outcome. And another is individual fairness, meaning that similar individual have similar profile should have similar outcome. But under this broad category, there's also different ways to measure what this similar outcome means. So that's a very big landscape. Again, similar to explainability, if you're interested in the topic of fairness, there are also lots of industry toolkits that, for one, it makes relatively easy to implement a fairness-related algorithm. And second, those toolkits also do a very good job in terms of introducing people to these different kinds of concepts to produce, provide educational materials to those different concepts. So Microsoft has one called FairML, and IBM, we used to work on one called AIF, AI Fairness 360. Moving on. So I have an interesting question regarding practitioner. So Kirthi, the question is, my thoughts on the product manager stakeholder who just look like a performance and judged model instead of actually understanding the model and data behavior. That's a great question. I think there's a cultural shift. I think years ago, people talk about explainability much less. From a data scientist point of view, right? Whenever you develop a model, performance metric is the first thing you grab to. And that's easy to produce, usually to provide. And that has always been the kind of standard for people to evaluate model. But I think a recent time, that view has really been challenged, especially with what I talk about, the documentation, model cards, this kind of transparent model reporting, right? So again, Google has Google model cards, Microsoft had transparency note. So that kind of framework really require whenever you're producing a model or putting a model out, you have to have very comprehensive information, not just the performance, but also how did you develop? What is the underlying assumption? What is the data? What is the intended or unintended use case? And even like this kind of algorithmic explanation is just one category of this kind of information you have to provide. So I think that's there's definitely this kind of cultural change to move towards transparency model reporting. But the challenge is, of course, that is also resource intensive, it's hard to produce, and sometimes it's not even possible for data scientists to articulate every kinds of consideration, what is the right use case, what is not. So that's, again, a very actively researched area, but personally, I'm hopeful that we're going to see this kind of cultural change and moving towards a more comprehensive model understanding and transparency. Do we have more time for one more question, or is it good?
Sure. How about one more question?
Okay, let me pick one more question. I have a question, Jen. How do we differentiate causal explanation versus some just be correlated? That's a great question. I am not an expert in causal ML, so I just give a very, very high level answer. So I think causal, whether explanation can be causal is related to whether the model is causal, right? Unfortunately, a lot of this kind of popular machine learning model themselves, they're not causal. So usually when you produce explanation, you can only describe what the model is doing. But there is a big trend of developing more causal model, and that kind of model can also generate this kind of causal explanation. So that is a very much actively researched area as well. I think that's that's a lot of great questions. I hope address your questions.
Well, thank you very much, Vera, and thanks for answering so many questions. And you can see this very popular. We still have a whole bunch of questions. But I think we'll stop here and thank everybody for attending the talk. It's getting late in the evening, at least in Toronto. A very popular talk. I think we had some point, 120 people.
Wow.
Vera, thank you so much for making the time. I know you're in California, so taking some time out from your day, and really appreciate it. Thanks everybody for attending. Wishing everybody a very good evening. Bye-bye.
Thanks everyone, bye.